I can do much better on the diffs, you know?
Oh, okay.
That's right.
Yes.
And you know, a house DJ is in the house when the show is starting with the house song. Good evening, Mzansi. Welcome. It is another exciting edition of Trending SA, and I'm still here adding some much needed what, some flavor, some ing on this third seat. And we're going to be unpacking all the latest trending stories today. Helping me do this is the ever lovely, the incredible, the sensational Rifilwe.
Just layered on salt base. Layered on.
Delicious, yes. My queen.
And
there he goes.
Of course, we have to acknowledge and mention the king of shade himself, Uma Blur.
I'm the emperor of Umlazi. I don't know where this place called shade that you speak of. I know nothing of it.
Rulers, emperor, rulers.
Speaking like a real emperor.
All right, so the hashtag Breckenfell High School has gained a lot of traction over the course of the last 2 days. I mean, yesterday we reported on the unrest which took place outside the school that saw parents of the learners clashing with the EFF supporters. I mean, it really was a mess.
And this morning the DA was all over my timeline when they posted what seemed to be their stance on the matter in a form of a Twitter thread that addressed the ongoing protests outside the school in Cape Town. The DA tweeted the following. He said, "The Nazis had brown shirts that went around terrorizing minorities. South Africa has red shirts. Hashtag Breckenfell."
So that thread sent Twitter into a frenzy, and now we are joined on the line by the Western Cape DA leader, Bonginkosi Madikizela, to basically respond to the aftermath of the party's tweet, as well as, you know, what happened outside the school and the entire situation that obviously got them to say what they said on social media. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for making time to speak to us, and welcome.
Guys, good afternoon and good afternoon to viewers.
Okay, now, as a DA member, I mean, you are insisting to likening the EFF to the Nazis, and you're saying it's actually not even insensitive. And then you further accuse the party of leading South Africa down the same path of this fascist Germany movement. I mean, what do you mean by this? What informs this position that you've taken as a party?
I think it's a fitting comparison. I mean, if you look at what the EFF has been doing, you know, across the country, you know, inciting violence, you know, making, you know, inflammatory statements that are divisive to South Africa. We don't need that. I mean, we are coming from a very, very painful past. As a country, we should be coming together and dealing with the challenges that we are facing. Now, it must be understood that the Nazis didn't just start by killing the Jews. Hitler, you know, started exactly the way the EFF started in South Africa. You know, it's interesting that people are outraged by this, because I remember Kwame Mantashe saying this as early as 2014. But of course, I mean, there are double standards in South Africa. When the DA says something, people, you know, become outraged. And the fact of the matter is this, is that the EFF cannot take the law into their own hands with impunity. We accept that there are challenges in South Africa, and racism is one of them. But the incident that took place in Breckenfell is very unfortunate, because one, the EFF embarked on an illegal march and they had no business being there. And secondly, they were so inconsiderate, given the fact that those students were writing exams. So if they wanted to raise the concern about what happened there, they should have followed proper channel. And for them to go and protest there, which resulted in the chaos that we saw yesterday, is unfortunate. Sure. But I must condemn as well the actions of parents, because, sure, I mean, you cannot, no one must be allowed to take the law into their own hands. But we must, you know, lay the blame squarely at the hands of the provocateurs, and that's EFF.
So just in the interest of time, I'm going to jump in, Mr. Madikizela, and ask you, you spoke about divisiveness and where we are as a country right now. And I read that thread, and I feel as though this is a recurring theme in some of the DA's communication, online, social media communication. I was with you, and I could buy your argument and receive the argument that you were laying out until that final tweet. And in the interests of unifying and creating consensus, do you not feel that that final tweet muddies the water and doesn't actually move the conversation forward? Because that's also what happens with social media, is that we hang on to that one problematic thing and suddenly the point we're arguing is lost.
Now, here's the truth here, and I think we must call the spade a spade. EFF thrives on divisions. And all the people who are behaving like EFF, because let me be frank here, that publicity stunt has nothing to do with the interest of black learners or black people. It was a political, you know, stance, which is designed, you know,
I hear what
to
you're saying.
Drive.
Yes, but the question is about your tweets and your communication and how it is that you're trying to consolidate an electorate that is divided, but one specifically that will be unified behind your own party. That's the question.
By calling out people who are dividing our country and calling them exactly what they are, I mean, is exactly what we need, so that we as South Africans can make sure that those people are not, you know, encouraged to continue doing what the EFF is doing.
Mm.
What is the problem currently in South Africa is that we want to say things that are politically correct. We want to sugarcoat things. Now, unity must not be, it mustn't be an artificial unity. I mean, but yes, we have to unite the country, but we must call out the people who are dividing us. And we mustn't sugarcoat issues, as I said.
All right. Mr. Madikizela, thank you so much for your time this evening and answering our questions.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you.
Appreciate it.
All right, so while the country was still reeling from the shock of the DA's utterances, the Western Cape Education MEC, Debbie Schaefer, added fuel to the fire when she responded to a tweet with the following. Take a look. She says, so if you have a private party and you invite only one race, is that discrimination?
I guess this sparked a lot of controversy as that hashtag Debbie, hashtag ABC of Education and hashtag racism took over the timeline, because this question left so many tweets unimpressed. What do you guys think about this addition to the argument?
I think it's a missed opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
She is the political leader of the party in that particular portfolio. Instead of taking a position that says diversity is key,
sure,
and we need to use schools to promote that idea that even as with all the differences we have, there are so many opportunities to bring our societies together, to bring our people together.
Mm.
I just think that she missed an opportunity to do that.
Absolutely.
Because taking almost a nonchalant position for me makes no contribution.
Yeah.
I just don't understand, Uthi, why are we still having these chats in 2020? Ne? And it's so problematic. I mean, I worry about the situation that we find ourselves in South Africa, because unlike we're not our parents, we're not our grandparents. We are not going to tackle these things the same way that they did. They did their best, you know what I'm saying? But we are a much more vocal generation. So I just think that in order for us, we are all raising kids and we all have vested interest in this country and we all want this country to actually thrive.
Mm.
I think we all need to actually get our together.
So we asked a political analyst, a friend of the show, Jamie Mighty, to help us respond or just understand Debbie's question. This is what he had to say.
The argument that this was a private event organized by parents with no relationship to the school is a flimsy argument and one that ignores the core issue at hand. It's a flimsy argument in the first instance because the parents are members of the school SGB. The event itself was advertised by the school. And moreover, it ignores that even private events are not allowed to discriminate in ways that are unconstitutional.
You know, guys, all I'm saying is, us parents of kids in primary school have already learned how to act, right? Mm. You send out invitations to the whole class.
Exactly.
You pray to God and your ancestors that those you don't like don't come. But Oksalayo, you invite everybody. Because what we don't want is other kids coming to school on Monday and feeling left out and feeling excluded.
Mm.
That's the first thing. But the second thing, Mo, is that this is an opportunity, once again, especially for the MEC, to just promote social cohesion.
Absolutely.
She lost such an important opportunity.
Completely missed there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But anyway, after the break, we continue our closer look into the aftermath of the hashtag Brackenfell, and the EFF head of presidency, Sinawo Tambo, responds to the DA's remarks about the party. See you in a short while.
Welcome back to Training SA. We are still carrying on that debate on what's going on in Brackenfell. And on the line, we're joined by economic freedom fighter, head of presidency, Usinawo Tambo, to react to the Brackenfell school, high school situation and some of the remarks that came through from the DA. Sawubona Bhuti, how are you?
I'm well, how are you, my brother?
I'm good. Baba, in the previous interview, we spoke to the DA, and basically this is what they had to say. They said that Hitler started the same way that the EFF started on. They said that the EFF thrives on divisions, and you guys need to be called out as dividers. So what do you have to say to that?
You know, one of the most tragic symptoms, right, of racial low self-esteem is thinking that the silly ideas that are in your head constitute objective reality. And that is what Madikizela has done in his performance and twirling for his white superiors in the DA by firstly arguing that the EFF gathered illegally outside of Brackenfell High School when there's no such law around gatherings anymore, which is part of their appetite to return this country to the dark days of apartheid, but also by comparing the EFF baselessly to the Nazis, an insensitive, implausible, and just ridiculous argument. I mean, what the mistake Madikizela makes is thinking that the uproar and the feelings of those that the DA want to court back into their voter base, which is what racist right-wingers, that their feelings constitute the law and can alter the law. And that is not the truth. When white people are upset, that doesn't mean the laws of this country must change. The courts today affirm that right by dismissing the SGB of Brackenfell High School for its appeal to interdict the EFF from protesting outside of Brackenfell High. There's no basis to compare the EFF to the Nazis. The EFF is a non-violent movement, a peaceful movement that practices democracy in this country peacefully. And protests are part of a method of engaging and ventilating one's frustrations into broader society. We witnessed an attack on peaceful picketers outside Brackenfell High School by what we regard as racist right-wingers. And the DA is just furthering its agenda and getting back into those people's hearts.
Now, the other thing, of course, is that the EFF has been slammed for this protest outside the school. In fact, the DA leader that we spoke to a few minutes ago even said that you guys are pulling what he called a publicity stunt. When you look at the intentions behind your presence there, what sort of outcome was the EFF looking for?
We were looking to hold two racist white teachers and the principal of Brackenfell High School to account, who legitimated a party that was constituted by white-only students at the exclusion of black students. And we did this with the consensus with black learners in that high school who are supporting us, who are reaching out to us and saying, look, we are happy that the EFF has come out on this matter. We've been feeling victimized in this school and they want to speak out, and that we're going to have a process of engagement throughout this week with those students. But on publicity stance, it's interesting to note that the DA has been able to say this, because if one looks at the incidences, namely in Senegal, where white racists stormed the court of law, fired guns, and of course bullied police officers, the DA has laid no charge against those people. The DA has laid no charge against the white terrorists that attacked defenseless and unarmed women outside of Brackenfell High School, because their commitment is to pursuing cases, frivolous cases against black people who ventilate their anger against racism in a peaceful manner. We must ask ourselves why the Democratic Alliance has not laid a single case against white racist attacks on black peaceful people in this country, which undermines our democracy, which undermines the constitution of this country. So it shows to us that the DA's commitment is not to any rule of law, but rather they are trying to victimize black people in order to appease and get back sort of affirmation from one racist. And Madikizela has been a puppet in this process, which is also very sad because he's not a spokesperson of the Democratic Alliance. Mm. He was just saying, bass, bass, watch me twirl, you know, look at me perform for you to get approval from them, which is very sad.
Yeah,
so that's the problem.
Mr. Tambo, I thank you very much. Just in the interest of time, we do have to adjourn our conversation. Perhaps next time we can have a conversation around the kind of wording that we utilize when we speak about the Madikizelas of the DAs and members of the party, and interrogate whether or not he does actually have agency. What if these are truly his ideas? But perhaps that's a conversation for another day. But really appreciate your insights. Thanks for coming on Training SA. And of course, the hashtag CRL hearings is currently trending. I'm stealing your your link, Mo. Later on in the show, so we'll be joined by Christian journalist Solomon Izang Ashrams to help us unpack that, as well as the two prominent cases that are making the news right now. That's against Prophet Shepherd Bashiri and televangelist Timothy Omodoso. You don't want to miss it.
We are still on your timeline. This is Quentin Essay. So, critical Christian journalist and the founder of Movement Against Abuses in Churches, Solomon Izang Ashoms, has been in the forefront of rooting out false prophets which have paralyzed the church system in the country.
And tonight he joins us to unpack the much-publicized cases of self-proclaimed prophets, Bushiri, as well as the televangelist Timothy Amudoso, as we also take a closer look into the legal cases which they're both facing at the moment, as we watch as well all these unconventional practices that have come to the fore just coming out of the churches. Good evening and welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for coming in.
Good to be with you guys.
We're very happy that you made it in studio. Let's get straight into it now, Solomon. Before we go too far, that hashtag CRL Rights Commission is currently trending.
Yeah.
Earlier today, you attended the CRL Rights hearings, the commission hearing on rape allegations against Bishop Stephen Zondo. Can you give us an update on this case, first of all, and how today's hearing ended or concluded?
This case has been going on for quite a while now. I met quite a lot of the people who testified today. You know, so you're talking about allegations ranging from abuse, sexual abuse, to financial abuse, to just the whole corruption and a bit of witchcraft, believe it or not. You know, so, and his sister actually was one of the people that testified, his blood sister,
his
biological
sister,
and also his niece. And he allegedly raped his niece way back. So, and there's also a whole lot. He ran the church like his business. You know, he has a trust where he moves money from the church's coffers into a family trust. Which, you know, so it's more like a business. So I've been investigating him for quite a while now. He had threatened me, you know, some times back. And it's just good to see that CRL could create some sort of hearing, because a lot of the victims were, some of them were groomed from a young age. They come for prayer, and then he raped them, single women, married women. Some of them, they believed in him so much. So whatever he instructs them to do, they do.
All
right. So you ran the fake Prophets Must Fall movement.
Yes.
Right? And that movement rubbed Prophet Shepherd Bushiri the wrong way. What are some of the, he took it to legal. What are some of the red flags that you saw? Because this was before we saw what's transpiring in the headlines right now.
You know, when I started talking about this, actually, I got a lot of stick, you know, death threats and intimidation. My wife was intimidated. I had to move out of the house. To
Wait, death threats from who?
From the supporters of this prophet. Okay. So, I mean, obviously, it's from the prophets, you know, and I've been to court several times because of that. But when I saw that, you know, I was running a magazine called Parable Magazine, Christian Magazine. So a lot of people were complaining about leaders. So when I saw it, I started talking about it. But no one was really paying attention, because, you know, in South Africa, we believe a leader is beyond reproach. A religious leader is beyond reproach. But the Bible is very clear in Matthew 25:25 that, you know, false prophets will come. They will deceive even the elect, I mean, people in church. So when I started seeing that, I've met Bushiri before, by the way. You know, I met him. We spent about 4 hours talking, and I warned him about this. Somebody actually forced me to meet him. I said, no, I'm not meeting him. He's a charlatan. He's a fake prophet. But she put pressure on me to meet him and do some media work for him, which I wasn't ready to do. But Bushiri is packaged. You know, the whole ECG thing is a package. You know, they look around the country and they see that people need hope, financial hope. You know, they need their health, they need hope. So they package it in such a way that, you know, God is going to solve all your problems. But God is not going to solve all your problems. It's very clear in the Bible, he's not going to solve all your problems. So they package that. So when I did that, Marge, he took us to court, allegedly, because he felt we were targeting just him. But we were targeting false prophets, because there's a lot of them, not just him.
So you caught feelings.
I guess in many ways the question becomes, you know, you've just mentioned Prophet Shepherd Bushiri's conduct. Of course, he's now been arrested for a number of criminal activities, including money laundering to the tune of 102 million. Do you think that Major One will face the consequences of his actions? And I'm guessing you're leaning towards the argument that he is in fact guilty of these. And what does real justice look like to you? Is this going to set a precedent for other pastors of like him?
Yeah, you know, because there's quite a lot of them. And the scary thing is there are the younger ones are coming up. There are some of the younger prophets in their early 20s. They're coming up. So they're going to do far worse than we see Bushiri doing. For me, I'll be very happy to see him you know, go to jail. I have records and evidences of so many people who are paid into this Forex business that he was arrested for and he got bailed. I have the, you know, they send me their slip of payment, their invoices and everything. You know, families almost got divorced. I know about a lady who actually got paralyzed because she took all her pension money and put in there. Mm. So we cannot be that heartless, you know. So for me, I would really want to see him. I know he has top lawyers. He has a lot of money. He's a multimillionaire. And he's going to fight it, obviously. But the good thing is there's a backup plan, which has to do with his immigration status. Okay. You know, yeah. So I would love to see him go back to Malawi.
You've obviously been in the wars with these particular cases. I mean, even if I bring in the televangelist, Timothy Omotoso, in that case.
My Nigerian man.
Yes, you actually played a big part in that. You provided evidence to the Hawks, and I don't even know if you're going to, you know, make yourself available if need be to take the stand. Just update us on that case as well.
Yeah, the case actually started when I got the report. It was from a group of young boys around the church who were friends to these young girls that Omotoso was sexually abusing. Mm. So they reached out to me because anytime the boys get closer to the girls, he kind of like, don't do that. So they got kicked out of the church and all that. So I got a lot of evidences from them, communications and messages. So the Hawks somehow got to know about me and they came here, took me up to PE, gave them the evidences, wrote an affidavit. And I might be, like you said, Mo, I might be, you know, appearing in court. But currently, he's been in jail. I think he's going 4 years in April in St. Albans Prison in PE. And he's been trying to get bail, but still, even last week, he was denied bail. Now he's appealing. Mm. But Omotoso is a very, you know, cunning person. He's been somebody who, musically, he's very talented. He used to belong to a band called Ebenezer Obey Band, big band in Nigeria. But for me, the girls that I've met that he had raped and what he had done to them is just so outrageous that I would really want to see him, you know, pay the price for it. And I hope that soon we're going
to
see that.
All right. We're going to have to put a pin in this conversation for now. What we're going to ask you to do is stay with us because we are going to carry on this conversation with a trending essay off air. So you can go to our YouTube live page and catch the rest of the conversation there as we interrogate why so many of us South Africans are so vulnerable to being taken advantage of. So that's how we wrap up tonight's episode of Trending Essay. Join us again tomorrow if you're not catching us on off air as we continue this very important conversation. The author of Church Mafia and Pastor Makado Ramabulana will be in studio shedding some light on his mind-blowing experiences and we're of course going to be joined by the CRL Commission representative. You don't want to miss any of it. Good night, Mzansi. Catch us on the socials.